Good morning, everyone. How are you all doing today on this nice, humid day? Well, it's a good day to be together and worship the Lord together. We have a lot of exciting announcements, so I just want to encourage you guys again to please make sure you open up the newsletters, because there's a bunch of stuff that doesn't always get put on the announcements. But I am going to highlight a few for you. This Saturday at 8 a.m., how many of you like to do yard work? I got one hand. Okay. Well, this is for you then. 8 a.m., we're going to have a church cleanup. We're going to clean up the grounds. If you're good at gardening, we're going to tackle the garth as well. So if you are interested in attending that, just come on down at 8 a.m. We also, if you're a mom and you are looking for some me time, we're going to meet Saturday at 8:30. So this is kind of like our women's breakfast. Like, we have breakfast, we have a lesson, we have fellowship and all of that. So if you're interested in attending that, you can put your connect card and we'll connect you with the details, because it is not located here at the church. Next Sunday, the 22nd, is a day of celebration. It's our Heritage Sunday. So we're going to take some time to honor our members who have been members for 50 plus years. So that's going to be a fun time. And then, looking forward a little bit, I know it seems like June 5th is so far away, but it's really not that far away. But June 5th is Pentecost, and we are going to get together for our Pentecost potluck fellowship. So right after this service, we'll have a time together. So please plan on staying. Bring a dish to share. There is a sign-up right in Brooks Hall that you can sign up for, or you can call the office. And if you have any questions, you can see Pat Pittington or Maria Lindsay. All right, so that's enough announcements. Let's come together and worship the Lord with our call to worship.
Give thanks to the Lord. We will call on God's name and make known his wonderful works. Seek the Lord continually. We will watch and listen for signs of God's grace. Together, let us worship God. Let us rejoice in God's presence and praise his holy name. Please stand if you are able. Hymn number 285 can be found in the blue hymnal. Thank you. Please be seated. Remember that our Lord Jesus can sympathize with us in our weaknesses, since in every respect he was tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with boldness approach the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Please join in saying the prayer of confession. Almighty God, we have been wandering in the wilderness of sin. We have complained in the face of your mercy. We have been selfish in the face of your sacrifice. We have not done your will. Teach us humility. Teach us gratitude. Infuse your spirit into our lives so that we might be reconciled to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us take a moment to silently confess our sins. When you were dead in your sins and in your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the Gloria Patri.
Children through fifth grade are dismissed to our adventures program. Let us continue our worship of God.
Joyful song and little let it on. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you for that. The Word of God is proclaimed. Our first scripture reading is found in the Old Testament book of Proverbs, chapter 22, verse 6. And I just want to preface the reading of God's Word with this information. Proverbs is a book of wisdom. It is not a book filled with God's prophetic promises. And so when we deal with wisdom, what we find is not guarantees, we find probabilities. And so when we read this verse, which has been misquoted for decades and centuries, we read it more like what you reap is what you sow. There is a high probability that this is the way it will turn out, but it is not a guarantee. The reason I say that is because speaking with my late great-grandfather, and he would say, why is it that some of my children follow the Lord while others want nothing to do with God? And then he would quote this verse because he was a man who knew his Bible. So here it is, Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6. You probably know this scripture. You may have heard it misquoted. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And our second reading is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. And I don't think you've heard this misquoted, because this is pretty straightforward. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate. Fathers, mothers, do not exasperate your children or grandchildren. Instead, bring them up in the training and the instruction of the Lord. This is the word of God. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that your word is seasoned with grace and power. Lord, that you enable us and empower us to live in your grace, so that our relationships with children, grandchildren, nieces and nephews, spouses, will reflect your relationship with us. So we pray, Lord, that the lessons you have for us today, through your wisdom, would be applied in our lives for your glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The title of today's message is The Perils of Parenting. Today, I want to talk about parenting. And it's a message for parents. But before you tune me out, if you're not a parent, it's also a message for grandparents, for godparents, for future parents, for aunts and uncles, coaches, teachers, caretakers, and anyone who has influence in the lives of young people. And so that means you. And I must admit, there is hesitation on my part to teach on parenting because I am not an expert dad. I am a new dad. And so my resume includes a whole 3.5 years of experience with our eldest daughter, Violet. So I'm making mistakes. I'm still in process. I'm learning on the go. But I want to start this message where my parenting journey began. And like many of you, my journey began in the hospital. The day our daughter Violet was born was one of the happiest days of my life. And the doctors and nurses were great. They supported us, and they told us that you can stay in the hospital for 2 days or three. And my wife and I are overachievers, and we said, we'll be done, we'll be gone out of your hands in 2 days. We can handle it. And then at the end of the second day, we said, can we please stay one more day? And then at the end of the third day, they told us it was time to go home. And I was kind of excited. I was okay emotionally until I put our little daughter in the back seat of our car. And what was one of the happiest moments of my life became one of the most terrifying moments of my life, because as we drove away from the hospital, and I admit, I am a guy who goes at least the speed limit, there were people all around us going the speed limit, and it was terrifying. I could not believe that our local government allows people to drive so fast. Why would they encourage us to go 35, 45, and 55 miles per hour? Didn't they know that there was a baby on board? And so this happy moment became a terrifying moment. And then when we got her home, I learned something very important. Even though I had parents, I didn't know how to be a parent. Even though I was a kid at one time, I didn't know how to raise kids. The nurses made it look so simple, but I didn't know how to bathe or swaddle my daughter. I was afraid if I tried to change her onesie, I would separate her shoulder. It didn't take time for me to understand that parenting, grand parenting, God parenting, teaching, coaching, is joyful, terrifying, heartbreaking, and glorious all at the same time. And Melissa and I understand, as many of you have told us, oh, you have it easy now. Little kids, little problems. Big kids, big problems. It's only going to get harder. And Melissa and I ask the question, and I'm open to your feedback and your advice. We ask and wonder, how will we talk to our children about gender and sexuality in a world that insists on having these conversations with children? How do we protect their mental health in a world with 24/7 access to pornography and violence? I saw one statistic this week that children, by the time they hit the age of 18, have seen over 10,000 murders on TV. If they've played video games, they're encouraged to do the killing. How do we teach them that their self-worth was determined by God, that beauty is in the eye of the beholder and not measured by their number of online social media followers? How do we get Violet, Ben, and baby number three from that car seat to the driver's seat without permanent damage? I come before you humbly, not pretending to be an expert, not even pretending to know much about parenting, but there is one thing that I do know, and that is I believe that parenting starts with a vision. Parenting, God parenting, grand parenting, coaching, teaching begins with a vision. And as we read, as we have not yet read, in Proverbs 29:18, King Solomon talks about vision. You may know this verse if you've been in church for a long time. Here's what Solomon wrote. Where there is no vision, the people perish. Where there is no vision, some translations say, people cast off restraint. I like the New Living Translation, which says, where there is no vision, the people run wild. This is why raising children starts with a vision. Pastor Liz and I went to a conference a few weeks ago, and it was led by a pastor named Tim Lucas, and Tim shared with us the vision that he and his wife Colleen wrote down for their children. Yes, they were not new parents. Their kids were graduating from college, but they raised their children with this vision. Here's what it says. We want our kids to be kind, compassionate, responsible adults who love Christ, share God's heart for the world, and use their gifts to serve others. And in the end, we want to be friends. Notice what's not in the vision statement. They didn't write, we want our kids to graduate at the top of their class. We want our kids to play Division I sports. We want our kids to have big jobs and live in big homes in Greenwich. And it's not because those things aren't nice things. They're just not number one on God's list for our children and grandchildren. Do you know that God has a vision for our children's lives? This verse is actually about God's vision for people. It's not simply that what we think up as the adults for the children. The word vision means prophetic vision or divine guidance. It's what God has in mind, had in mind before we were born and our children were even born. And God's vision for the next generation may or may not include academic success. God's vision for our children may or may not include success in the boardroom or on the ball field. But do you know what God's vision most certainly does include? God's vision for the next generation includes developing godly character, right? Before, it's about what we do, it's about who we are. God's vision for our children includes spreading Christ's love in a world that is in such desperate need of Christ's love. And God's vision for our children most certainly includes you. And so if you're thinking about having a vision for those special little ones that God has placed in your life, no matter what stage they're in, I want to encourage you to ask these questions. What kind of adults do you want them to be? What do you truly want for your kids? I would also include this, that you would pray. And this sermon is not about the importance of praying for your kids, but that is most certainly foundational. But what I would encourage you is to take some time with the Lord and with an open Bible and ask God, what is your vision for them? And if your vision is some sort of variation of kind, compassionate, responsible adults who love Christ and serve others, then I want you to know that First Presbyterian Church of Fairfield is here to help you achieve that vision. We have a common vision. This is why on Sundays we don't just provide babysitting or child care. We have an adventurers program that teaches your kids what it means to be loved by God, follow Christ, and serve others. This is why Pastor Liz said to me this week, our adventurers program and our family Sunday services, they'll continue throughout the summer because we're not taking a break from helping your kids live into God's vision. This is why this fall we are starting a weekday adventurers program that combines the fun of sports with ways to help our kids develop godly character. And it's not just about our vision for the littlest ones. We are praying for God to send us middle school and high school leaders to restart those programs. And you might be sitting here today, and we ask you to join us in praying and also to consider being a part of the answer to those prayers. Today, I want you to know that your church family has an intentional and strategic plan to plant those seeds of faith in our children's hearts so that they can grow into God's vision for their lives. Here's where you fit in. I want to be honest and vulnerable with you. Our church programs are not enough. Our church programs are not enough for your kids, your tweens, and your teenagers or young adults. Do you know that the average church has 40 hours a year with your children? Do you know that the average parent has 3,000 hours a year? For the kids to grab a hold of God's vision for their lives, it's going to include you. Paul wrote this to the church in Corinth: follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. That's 1 Corinthians 11:1. He says, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, teachers, one of the primary keys to raising godly children is being the living, breathing example of God's vision. In other words, you can't give it if you don't live it. Honor is a big part of our values as a family and as a church family. And I have to say, if honoring people is part of my vision for my children, I can't expect my children to honor their mother or to honor me if I don't honor their mother and honor them. I can't expect them to be kind and compassionate when dad is the one who's always pointing out their flaws, kicking them when they're down or jumping down their throat. We have to be the example. To impart the vision, we must model the vision. You know, some of you have participated in our Common Ground 9 a.m. service, and if you have, you've seen my daughter jumping around while the band plays those praise songs. She jumps around and she has her hands up to praise the Lord. You might be wondering, why does she do that? How does she know to do that? It was COVID. It was COVID that changed the dynamic in our household. See, before COVID, we just relied on the church to teach our children how to worship and pray. But during COVID, they closed down the church. And we understood that if we were going to worship God, we had to worship God as a family, that we would have to be the example. And so what we did was, we did what a lot of people do when they want to find out how to do something new. We went on YouTube and we put on a worship song and we turned it up loud and we started jumping up and down and dancing and praising the Lord together. That's how our children are learning to worship God. Mom and dad have to be the example. My daughter knows the Lord's Prayer. How does she know the Lord's Prayer? Often at the contemporary service, we don't even say the Lord's Prayer. Where would that come from? It's from the parents. Because the reality is, your children, your grandchildren won't always say what you do, but at some point they will do what you do. Model the vision to impart the vision. Be the living, breathing example of God's vision, and they will catch God's vision for their life. Second thing that we can do: reinforce God's vision through training. We read this verse from Proverbs 22. Train them in the way that they should go, and when they are older, they will not turn from it. Train them in the way that they should go. When I think of training, I think of discipline. And often we think of discipline as something that's bad. You're being punished. What if discipline was more correction than punishment? What if discipline was more about direction, leading them in the way they should go, and less about hurting them or teaching them a lesson? Discipline is about building them up, helping them to improve. An athlete must be disciplined in order to go to the next level. A student must be disciplined in order to achieve academic success. And that's the same in our spiritual lives and the spiritual lives of our children. And I just want to be clear that discipline doesn't mean ignoring disrespectful, dishonoring, and dangerous behavior. Ignoring it rewards it, and what's rewarded is repeated. And so discipline does mean that you have to allow your children and grandchildren to feel the full weight of the consequences of their actions. So let me give you a little example of what discipline looks like with our three-year-old. How many of you know that children are innocent in some ways and sinful in others? Yeah, can we just put down the pop culture of spirituality in our nation? Our kids are a blank slate. You've never been alone with a three-year-old. Give me a break. Right? And the Bible teaches this, right? We're all born in sin with the sinful condition. And so I have to tell you that this isn't surprising. We didn't even have to teach our kids how to lie. They just did it naturally. And so one of the things that our daughter lies about is dessert. And so she lies about dessert because she thinks if she can convince us that she hasn't had dessert, she can have more dessert. And so, you know, I come in and she asks for dessert, and I ask her, "Have you already had dessert?" And what does she say? "No." And I see chocolate on her cheek. "Violet, tell Daddy the truth. Have you already had dessert?" "No." And I can see cookies in her teeth. "Violet, now come on. Really, tell Daddy the truth. Have you had dessert?" "No." I can see the remnants of the dessert on her hands. So then what do I do? What I've been doing since she was, you know, what I've been doing consistently. Punish her. "You've had dessert. You're lying. Time out. You're going into time out." Gets out of time out. "Violet, have you had dessert?" "No." Okay. That's not working. So what do? We let her watch one show. The show's called Mouse. "Violet, you can't watch Mouse tonight because you're lying. Have you had dessert?" "No." So that's not working. So now I have to think about other ways to do it. You know what worked? When I started to offer grace. Right, this is the Christian way. This is what makes Christianity different from every other religion. It's called grace. You get something good that you don't deserve. You're lying and you're sinning, and I'm offering you grace. And so I was begging for her this day to stop lying about it. And so I finally, you know, finally it's like, "Did you have dessert?" She said, "Yes." I said, "You told the truth." Telling the truth is great. We tell the truth in this household. God is all about truth. Jesus is the truth. We tell the truth. You get cake. Yesterday, she wanted some of my lunch after she had lunch. "Violet, have you already had lunch?" "No." "There's ketchup on your cheek. Have you already had lunch?" She caught on. "Yes." "Great. You told the truth. You get Daddy's potatoes." She starts eating the potatoes. "Violet, did you have lunch?" "Yes." "More potatoes. You told the truth." Right, we're talking about training and discipline, and it's a silly example, and you have young people in your life at different stages, and you're smart enough to figure it out depending on their age. But you have to reinforce the vision. It's not a one-time thing. It takes a lifetime. The last thing I want to say about vision and raising our children with vision is this. You know what I'm going to say? If you've been around me for you know, the last year and a half since I've been your pastor, if you've been around church for a long time and you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you know what comes next, right? Because we're a people of love, right? God is love. And so our religion, our faith in God is all about love. It's all about loving people well, whoever's in our life. And so the last thing that goes into raising up young people in God's ways is love them. God gave you the authority and the responsibility. God put you in their lives to love them. And there was this one particular verse about love, and Paul writes about love in 1 Corinthians 13, and you can read all about what love is and what love isn't. But in 1 Corinthians 13, I believe it's verse 7, he says, "Love always protects." We have to protect the young people in our lives because the world is throwing everything at them to pull them away from God's vision. What isn't God's vision? We live in a society that it's often glorified and normalized and celebrated. And so what does it mean to protect our children? One of my friends, he ran a technology company, and it was technology education, very successful business. And he used to tell me, he'd say, Greg, the most dangerous thing in the world is a 14-year-old with an unmonitored, unprotected phone. It's dangerous for them and to them. Love protects. Protect your children. If you don't know what's happening on their phone, you don't know what's happening in their life. Here's a really kind of funny line. This is what kids say to their parents. You can't take away my phone. My phone. Whose name is on the bill? Who bought the phone? I hope someone's watching or listening and they wake up. It's not their phone. You're the owner. You paid for it. It's your phone. And when you want your phone back, it's yours. You can have it back. Can I get an amen? Protect your children. It's not about hurting them. It's about protecting them. And I always err on the side of overprotection because it's harder to take back freedom than it is to give a little more freedom. This is really the last thing I'm going to say. Love them. We're going to mess up. We're going to sin against them. We're going to sin against our children. That's what we do to the people closest to us. And they're going to mess up. They're going to sin against us. Peter wrote this in 1 Peter 4:8. Above all, love each other deeply. Love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sins. Some of you are familiar with Pastor Rick Warren of Saddleback Church in Colorado. He wrote Purpose Driven Life, and he told this story. I think it's important for us to hear it because our kids aren't going to remember everything that we say, but they're going to remember what we do, and they're especially going to remember what we do when the chips are down and they need to be supported and loved. And so Rick Warren tells this story about his daughter. His daughter was trying out for the cheerleading squad in high school, and her and all her friends tried out. She felt like she had a great tryout, and she didn't make the cheerleading team. So she went to the coach and said, Coach, I thought I executed everything you asked of me. Why didn't I make the team? And the coach said to her that she was too big to be a cheerleader on the team. And it broke this little high schooler's heart. It broke her self-esteem. It broke her. And Rick says that he and his wife heard her come home that day. She ran up into her room and she went into the closet. She closed the door and she was weeping uncontrollably, loudly. And they could hear her weeping from downstairs. So Rick and his wife, they went upstairs. They opened the closet door. They didn't tell her to get up. They didn't say something like, it's no big deal. It was a big deal for their girl, and it was a big deal to them. They didn't say, we're going to get that coach, and we're going to make sure that he never coaches again. They didn't give in to anger. They got on the floor. They wept with her as she wept. And when they were done weeping, they picked her up, and they got up together as a family. And they faced the hurt and the pain together as a family. And do you know what that girl experienced that day through her parents? The love of Jesus Christ. That's what got her through it. The love of Jesus Christ through her parents. Friends, we have the perfect parent, God the Father. He shows us how to be parents, grandparents, godparents, aunts, and uncles, to raise up his children so that they will know his love and spread his love in this world. So what's your vision? What's God's vision for the young people in your lives? And how can you live out that vision and show them God's love so that one day they live in the fullness and the goodness and the joy of God's vision for their lives? Be the vision. Have the vision. And may God's vision and God's will be done. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand, if able, as we say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray together. Holy and gracious God, loving Father and fountain of wisdom, by your word, you set the universe in place, and with your hands, you molded us into your image. Everywhere we see signs of your loving care. Guide us always into your ways, that in your wisdom we might find abundant life and live forever in the splendor of your glory, through Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, on this day, and especially this day, we pray for those that you have placed in our families and church family. We lift up our children, tweens, teenagers, and young adults. Lord, now more than ever, they need to know your name, know your ways, and to know your love. We pray that they would come to know you in a special way, that we would be able to train them in your ways, and that when they're older, they would not depart from it. And we ask for forgiveness for the ways in which we've sinned against our children and they have sinned against us. We ask that by your grace, we would forgive those in our families who have left lasting wounds on our hearts. Lord, free us from the bonds of unforgiveness to love as you have loved us. We especially lift up those in our community who are suffering with COVID, grieving the loss of loved ones. We ask for the Piddington family as they grieve the loss of Pat's brother Jack. We pray for those in our lives who are struggling today. We lift them up to your throne and pray that you would use us to pull them up, especially our children. And we lift up those who have been affected, shattered, hurt, terrorized by war and violence. In your mercy, forgive, cleanse, and heal us, and heal our fallen world. And hear us now as we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to stand for our doxology and our closing hymn, and also invite you to consider giving. If you're watching online, you can give financially through our website. If you're here in person, we do have offering plates in the back, and you're welcome to give of your offering on your way out, as well as place your connection cards in those plates. Please stand, if able, as we continue our worship of God. Thank you. I invite all of you to enjoy the joy of fellowship in our coffee hour in Brooks Hall following our service. And now as we go from this place, keeping our eyes fixed on our perfect parent, God the Father, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all on this day and forevermore. And all God's children say together, Amen.
May the Lord show his mercy upon you. May the light of his presence be your guide. May he guide you and uphold you.